This small valley right to the north of Barichara, Colombia, used to be a rich forest grove, home to howler monkeys, parrots, and the stream Lubigara, which brought water to the area year-round. But as tobacco became more popular and more profitable in the 1940s and 50s, and at the end of La Violencia, which split the municipality of Barichara into two, the liberal Barichara and the conservative Villanueva, which literally means the new village, economic opportunity was seized, the forest torn down, and tobacco production ramped up. Along with food crops to support a growing population, the tobacco industry quickly used up the water accumulated over centuries in underground aquifers, and as its profitability sunk due to decreasing demand in the 80s, the 30 years of monocrop extravaganza were over. The now barren land was filled up with grass for cattle to graze on. But while grass is better than barren earth, it is not enough to maintain high-quality topsoil that can suck up rainwater and slowly filter it into the water table. So the aquifers, instead of filling back up, were actually drained even further as humans dug ever deeper wells to be able to maintain their livelihoods. At this point, the Lubigara creek bed is empty almost throughout the year, and water usage is a constant issue for people in the area. In order to revive the stream and solve this issue, we obviously need to increase water infiltration again, which means slowing the water with keyline on-contour trenches and natural barriers, and then preventing evaporation through sufficient plant cover. But how do we do that? Luckily, there are projects like the Reserva El Totumo, and people like its guardian, Manuela Angel, leading the way, testing which techniques work best in this area. So, say hello to Manuela.
I worked for around 35 years, mostly in the United Nations, in two of its organizations, one World Food Program and the other one FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the UN, and mostly related to rural development and humanitarian assistance. The nature reserve, El Totumo, is like an L-shaped reserve, if you look it up in a map. And it has the cliff face that comes down from the town of Barichara, where we were not intervening at all because the slope is very high. There's a specific structure to the vegetation that grows there. There's constant rock falls. We are leaving that to nature. There's an area on the back of El Totumo that has recently been purchased that has the most beautiful forest that El Totumo has. These are like 20 to 50 year old guaymaro trees, which is the Mayan nut tree, and it has this old water reservoir. And when I say old, nobody knows when it was constructed, but this was where people came down with their animals, with their bags, with whatever recipients they had to gather water to take home. And we have this area on the south side of the nature reserve where we're doing most of our experiments, trying to help nature do things faster. And so that's where we're trying out all the techniques that come by us, by our volunteers, the ones I've read about, the ones that Alfredo, who's the guy who helps out, thinks are the most useful ones, the ones that our teachers in tropical agriculture teachers have said are the best ones. We've tried everything. And most things are working. One of the biggest problems in El Totumo is water, because it's basically hilly. When it rains here, it rains really hard and water just leaves very fast and does not infiltrate into the terrain because the soil is hard, the soil has no organic matter. It's not like a sponge, and we want it to become like the forest floor, which is basically a sponge that sucks in water.
Truly rich soil can store up to 50% of its weight in water, which makes it the first massive step in restarting the local water cycle. For that, we need to accumulate biomass that can serve as home for the various fungi and other microorganisms which actually create our high-quality soil by decomposing plant matter, and living ground cover to protect this new soil from the sun, slow erosion, and prevent evaporation. And there are few techniques better at this than syntropic agroforestry. During the last years, Manuela has been able to test various combinations of syntropic agroforestry systems for this initial accumulation phase, and the results have been incredible. Look at the size of those plantains, which are barely a year old. So let's learn about the basic syntropic agroforestry principles Manuela applies to start up her systems.
Diversity is essential to nature. Every plant will bring with it specific functions to that system. Some will fix nitrogen, some will provide more humidity, some roots of some plants like the cassava plant will break soil that is very hard, helping out other roots to go into that very hard soil. And every plant will attract also insects and possibly what we call pests that are insects doing their job. And if it's unbalanced, well, those will become, according to our language, pests. But usually if you have diversity of plants, those that have become pests will be eaten by others and there will be more of a balance in that system. Usually in conventional agriculture, and even this was done in El Totumo 2 years ago through a planting scheme with the municipality, is that they plant future trees or intermediate trees. When I say it's those that remain in the system for decades and centuries, are planted all by themselves on soil that isn't ready, has not accumulated enough organic matter to provide for the needs of those trees. So what we do is to plant high density plants of all kinds, and especially the initial plants, those pioneers, those plants that a system requires to increase soil movement, root movement, leaf matter, those plants that I can prune and provide food for the system. And also pruning improves and provides a push to the system in order for it to grow again.
My two favorite learnings offered by syntropic agroforestry are, on the one hand, death is normal. And on the other hand, while we can analyze natural processes under the lens of competition, the lens of cooperation can be just as useful. Yes, planting in high diversity will mean that we will prune away some plants as the system develops. But until then, they have been able to maximize photosynthesis in every square meter planted, and are now able to offer their biomass as nutrients to the system. Yes, we can say plants compete for sunlight, but we can also see them exchanging nutrients and moisture, giving shade and protecting from the wind. This brings us to the third very important principle, stratification. Different plants have different needs for sunlight. Coffee can produce 2 harvests instead of 1 per year in Colombia when planted directly in the sun. But since it is naturally a shade plant, it will live longer and produce higher quality fruit when grown in the shade of bigger trees, as we saw at Agua Santa. And lastly, succession. To refill the aquifers, a climax forest obviously is the desirable end state. But to make this possible, 2 things are needed again: water and nutrient-rich soil. This obviously doesn't happen overnight. So during the first few years, our mission is to constantly spiral upwards, growing smaller plants, accumulating biomass to enrich the soil, increasing its capacity to store water, growing bigger plants, accumulating even more biomass, enriching the soil even more, and storing and infiltrating even more water. In syntropic agroforestry, this concept is called succession. Planting plants with shorter life cycles and lower demand for nutrients, along with plants with longer life cycles and higher nutrient demands.
We're asking that system to evolve rapidly into an accumulation type of system, but very rapidly. And sometimes it doesn't work because the soil is so poor and so degraded that most of the initial plants will grow, but not the future trees. So we try again until the soil is ready to give us the magic of a future tree, to see it grow, to see it start sprouting. It's marvelous.
There are, of course, many challenges along the way. Ants and larvae will happily take down any plants they find struggling. Convincing workers who are used to monocultures and trying to get every single plant to survive to suddenly plant in high density takes a while. But luckily here, the results speak for themselves. And so, at least in my humble opinion, syntropic agroforestry, through its focus on rapid biomass generation and its insightful use of pruning and succession, really shows that it's just as useful a tool for regenerating local water cycles, as, for example, water retaining trenches are.
I want to start seeing water seeping on the soil and not being down there probably 20, 30 meters below ground, because that's where we understand the water table is right now. From being 60 years ago to being available on top of the soil to being right now 30 meters below ground. So we'd love to have a spring coming off, that's my dream, and it being available for the community, having water and having the possibility of sharing with all creatures on Earth. Because without water, there's no life on Earth. It will be very dry, very hot. And it's what's happening in most parts of the world if we don't look after nature.
Water conflicts are beginning to pop up all around the planet, but Manuela and her helpers are showing that we are not helpless in front of this. So, let's regenerate the Earth.
Sometimes things don't work. You plant, and for some reason it didn't rain, an animal ate the seeds, or they rotted because it was too wet, and it didn't work. We try again. We always try again. And if it doesn't work, we're doing something wrong. Let's see what's going on. And we tried something different. I'm convinced we can do it, and we can show people that they can do it.